Many can remember the time when an empty bottle found alongside the road meant a candy bar at the grocery. The nickel reward that the container had on its head kept youngsters alert during their travels, and the amount of bottles seen on the highways was considerably lower than today. There will be an initiative on the fall ballot that, if passed, would revitalize the bottle hunt custom. The bottle bill has faced opposition from industry and past legislatures, and the initiative is the answer the environmentalists have chosen to shake the proposed law loose from the political arena. But the pressure from industry that opposes this method of controlling litter on Alaska's lands is not lessening. You might think of spring as being one of the most beautiful times in Alaska, but if you drive any of Alaska's highways, the evaporating snow reveals what 6 months of passing motorists think of their land. In some places, the mess is unbelievable. The need for some control of the rampant trend of throwing litter on streets, highways, and trails is obvious. Alaska's trash problem is not limited to highways. There is a waste disposal problem throughout the state. Oil drums scattered wherever man has established residence. Equipment left on the Aleutian Islands from the war. Packing crates that house shipments for the long trip to Alaska and are far too costly to return to the shipper. The problem is becoming more predominant because in some places we are simply running out of room, and plowing it under or piling the junk heap higher is becoming less acceptable. Just how bad is the litter problem along Alaska's roads? Well, Mrs. Walter Butts takes time out to pick up litter along the highway in Juneau.
It's a messy mess. They just leave it in the car, put it in a bag, and take it home, put it in a garbage can, instead of throwing it out along the highway for the scouts and the Girl Scouts and the church children to pick up and clean up after them.
Why do you go out and clean up bottles every once in a while?
Why do I? Because it bothers me. It just bothers me to see that place so cluttered up with their ugliness and bottles and cans and just trash in general, not just cans or bottles, it's everything. Papers and cigarette cartons and everything.
Every year in most Alaskan communities, there's a collective effort to round up all the scraps of paper, bags, containers, bottles, and cans. And in Fairbanks, the Girl Scouts, Boy Scouts, and other civic groups pitch in and give the shoulders of the roads a spring cleanup. George Brennan is the scout executive in Fairbanks.
Last year we had almost 6,000 bags of garbage picked up.
And how many people were involved?
Last year we had 2,100 roughly youth and about 500 adults working with them. So about 2,600 people all together.
What do you see as being the real value of this?
Well, probably the biggest value, as I see it, is the educational value that happens when a youth has to bend over and pick up that can or that piece of trash or the garbage that's been thrown out by somebody. And they realize that this is littering, it's unsightly, and somebody has to do something about it.
Leaving refuse along the trail and throwing trash from moving cars has become such a growing problem that lawmakers and environmentalists are clamoring for an incentive not to throw bottles and cans along the roads. This incentive to keep bottles and cans is provided in the bottle bill in the form of a 10-cent deposit on all beverage bottles and cans. Lobbying for this legislation and a prime mover of the initiative drive is Virginia Dal Piaz, lobbyist for the Alaska Conservation Society.
People being able to do something themselves to help decrease litter, save energy and materials resources, it's something everybody can be involved in, everybody can feel a part of contributing to this type of less wastefulness. And I do think a lot of our society is very waste generating. And the fact that these things are available, they're very heavily advertised, pop and beer, go out and buy it and use it and everything. They contribute very significantly to degradation of the environment through littering.
Representative Mike Miller from Juneau is the sponsor of the bottle bill.
It's just absolutely ridiculous, ludicrous, that we're still just, tossing aluminum and glass out on the highways.
What is the bottle bill?
The bottle bill, and of course that's a little bit of a misnomer, because it also is a bottle and can bill, is frankly a mandatory refund bill, which means that if I go to the grocery store or to the liquor store or whatever and buy a bottle of pop or a bottle of beer, whatever, I pay an extra dime and take my pop out and drink it, bring the can back later, and I get my dime back, which means that that can or the bottle doesn't end up on the highway. And that's what it's really all about. And it's really just that simple.
The bottle deposit process may seem easy for some, but it is not viewed the same way by people in the beverage business. The proposed law does not include rural areas, so there will still be disposable containers being shipped to Alaska. Jerry Abramezyk is chairman of the Industry Environmental Council, a group organized by beverage distributors and retailers with the express purpose of blocking the bottle initiative.
The manufacturing process for the container that the beverage goes in has to set up separate staging for that. They have to manufacture two sets of bottles for Alaska, deposit, non-deposit. Then we have to take into account the transportation distribution system. They pick that bottle up from the manufacturer, fill it, and their accounting system to get it back up here to Alaska is impacted greatly on the transportation distribution end. Then we account for it from the standpoint of the retailers who has to handle the bottle in itself. They have to stock it. Once the bottle comes back, because the grocery outlet will be the receiver of the empty bottle, they have to receive it, they have to pay the refund for it, they have to take care of the sorting aspect, the type of container and where it comes back to before it goes back to the distributor. They have to have storage space in the back, they have to ship it back to the distributor. And the biggest factor involved with all of that is that you have an empty container that has some residue left. The health problem, the sanitation factor is probably the number one that they'll have to account for. The consumer will wind up paying extra cost on every stage in order to get that bottle that he wants to enjoy. The second factor is that where you really can't put a price on is one of consumer choice. Right now, go down to any grocery store, any outlet that you have, and you'll find a wide range of choice of beverages. Under a mandatory deposit system, that choice is going to be diminished. That's been proven fact in Oregon, where they have a bottle bill now. Your private labels have disappeared. Some of the major manufacturers' name brands will reduce their offerings because that has to be sorted by type. So the consumer ultimately winds up paying extra cost for the product to get it, and secondly, he's going to wind up losing the choice that he now has.
So what is industry's answer to the litter problem? Senator Mike Colletta has introduced industry solution to the Alaska Senate.
Under my proposal, we would furnish employment to youngsters in the creation of a Model Litter Act, where we would have a year-round pickup of all litter.
And how would that be funded?
That would be funded by what in Washington State has proven to show is a non-pass-through tax. It's an assessment on industry, on the sellers and the manufacturers of the litterable items. Those things that fall into the litter stream. But the tax is so minimal, 1/20 of 1%, which equates to $500 on $1 million worth of gross sales. But the collective total of this non-pass-through tax represents some $600,000 a year.
The Model Litter Control Act is modeled after Washington State's anti-litter law, and it provides for a tax on items that are commonly discarded in inappropriate ways. The money is then turned over to the State Division of Parks and Recreation, where a crew of 40 litter patrolmen would scour the parks, highways, and trails, picking up after Alaskans, tourists, and debris scattered by industry. Environmentalists say this is a diversionary tactic to distract from the bottle legislation. Industry has made it plain that this is a matter of principle, and free enterprise solutions are better than government regulations.
Bottle bill has become a symbol for the national environmental movement, and we feel that somewhere along the line, and business is taking that side now, you have to draw the line and saying this far and no further. That they're well-meaning, yes, but the impact and the negative impacts that are occurring from that are too great, and now we're saying this is it, we'll go no further, and we will stand up and tell the other side on what is really happening with the environmental movement, on the economy, on jobs, on the distribution system, the whole society as a whole.
The state does have assistance in a small way from paid litter patrols. For a reminder of what a relatively trash-free roadside looks like, take a drive by a military reservation. They keep the public road clear of debris in the vicinity of their installations.
It's nice to keep Alaska clean like it should be, so I appreciate doing it. Forum, keeping it clean.
What are the merits and disadvantages to the two proposals? Well, the two approaches have basic philosophic differences in responsibility of litter control. The bottle bill offers a chance at changing our attitude toward disposable containers. An industry, while admitting the problem of litter, thinks that bottles and cans are just a small part of the overall litter problem. Anchorage is the only place in the state that offers a recycling process to the public. A recycling collection point is operated by the Alaska Center for the Environment. It collects weekly paper materials and aluminum cans. Both of these are mulched. The paper goes into fiber insulation, and the cans are shredded and sent outside for reprocessing into cans again. The biggest problem for the mammoth beverage business in the state is the handling of the different types of containers that will have to be distributed. With the bush being exempt from regulation, two types of bottles and cans will have to be manufactured and sent in and out of Alaska. One distributor, K&L, sells over 2 million bottles and cans per month. Henry Jackson is the operations manager for K&L.
Well, it's quite obvious that we don't have the space to take care of the excess litter that this bill would cause to come upon us. We would certainly have to look at making arrangements for more storage space to handle the bottles and the cans that come back in at an added cost.
At an added cost to who?
Well, the ultimate consumer would bear the cost of such a bill if it's passed. So.
Senator Colletta hopes that the Model Litter Control Act will get out of the Senate this session, but holds little hope for passage in the House. There will be an active campaign against and in support of the bottle initiative this fall. But none of the legislation can truly make Alaskans more responsible in keeping its landscape unlittered. That responsibility rests with each of you.